Hi, this is Cindy. Sorry, I forgot to unmute.
And Michael.
From Part-Time Permies, and I see, Kiri, you changed your name. I love it. Built on the Rock Homestead.
She says that's what she's got mostly is rocks, so that's good.
She's been talking about that. So, yeah, I'm going to change my view here slightly so I can see multiple screens. I really need a second screen. That would help this out a lot. Anyway, we got a number of people in here, and we'll get going. Can I get a verification you guys can hear me? Because I think I hit the right unmute, I believe. But that would be nice to know. So yes, Pine Brook Homestead. I was making tea as well. I was just getting some mint tea for tonight. Who else is in here? And welcome to the show. I think this is your first time at our live show. Awesome. Linda Taylor, Incense Shop, and
Delia's
back.
Yeah, nice to see you again.
I haven't seen your, oh wait, your mom's not going to be here tonight.
Yeah, they're in Florida.
Forgot about that. And Suburban Hillbilly and Valerie are in here. Hello, hello.
10 million zillion rocks, yes. Well, you know, the grapevine, some of the best quality wine in the world is grown in Spain and France, and the soil is almost completely granite and limestone and rock.
Yep.
So maybe you should think about growing some awesome stressed grapes for killer wine.
There you go.
Might be a 20 or 30 year project.
Oh, two wild onions. Welcome. Welcome. So
Texas has a little bit of wine, by the way.
It's
48 states have commercial wine, and Texas has limited, but some very good, few very good places.
So we have a number of things we'll go through today. We, for those of you guys, a couple new people in the room, we do, well, usually a foraged food feature, but this week I decided to do an herbal feature. So we're we're featuring lavender, which we do grow in our garden, and we don't really harvest it much. We don't have a lot of it.
We should, it's growing out better if this crazy cold snap doesn't kill it all.
We're supposed to get a bunch of snow. It should shelter.
Yeah, it should be fine. It's not the cold, it's the snow cover, and we're getting possibly 8+ inches tonight.
Yeah.
So that'll shield all of our young plants that are hardy.
Yeah, the fire is going well.
Yeah.
Going good.
But no, we like lavender a lot.
Yeah.
A lot of good uses for it.
Yeah, I actually have it in the teapot on the fireplace right now, in not to drink, but just for the
aroma. Olives too, stressed and in rocky country. Yes.
Yep.
Those are your weeds. Your awesome high quality weeds are olives and grapes.
Yeah, so we have
Welch's grapes that grow around.
Yeah,
a lot of juicing grapes are at commercial around the corner from us, but yeah, Delaware, Concord, things like that. But they're really not good wine grapes. They're that really juicy grape stuff.
There's a lot of wineries around here too, but
there are a lot of wineries. They're okay. They're good. They're not amazing, but they're good. Yeah. They're drinkable. Very drinkable. So,
hi, Square One Farms. Good to see you guys. Okay, so we do have a number of things. We'll be going over lavender. We'll be going over our Ask the Chef segment a little bit later. So if you have questions, Mike, for those of you guys who don't know who are new, Mike's a chef, and we just throw out questions, any cooking related questions you have for him, and we'll do that a little bit later. We'll go through a bunch of, you know, what we posted this week, what's been going on this week, and all that, and just free form otherwise.
Your olives should grow, but you are going to have to massage them a little bit and make sure they're watered. Until they've matured and they really take a deep root, they're going to need watering. And same with grapes. But once they're in and they're going, they should need minimal attention other than a light watering when it gets super, super dry.
So I do think we have a number of new people in the room and new channels, I believe. I'll have to go back and check some of you.
Random Mini Farm,
I think
that's a new
one. Are you
new?
Haywire,
we know.
Hello, Haywire.
Pine Brook.
And Lois Ann. Hello, hello. Welcome.
Square One, I'm not sure about. New
Square
first time?
One, yeah, I think. So, you guys, since we often go over foraged items and we go over gardening and stuff and growing food and a lot of different things, but to get an idea of where everyone is at, why don't we go ahead and list what states you're in, what provinces if you're in Canada, or what countries if you're in a different part of the world.
Yeah, we've been getting Scotland a lot recently. That's kind of cool. We like that.
Yep, and that's middle of the night for them usually. So
husband killed your grapevine.
Oh no. Oh no. Yes. Grapevines would be kind of fun to have a couple.
I would love to put a few in. That's kind of because we are in a great barrier. We can't stress them because we have water 10 feet. We have sand, which is great.
But then we have water.
But it's like 6 to 10 feet down, which means it gets a taproot and it can suck all the water at once.
It's great for juice.
Juice, but not, and it could make brandy, but I don't distill.
Yeah.
I'd love to make wine, but it's a pain in the butt. It's just so hard compared to making beer or something.
So we have a couple in Texas, Georgia, Ohio, Arkansas.
Have you ever made potato sausage? I don't know. I'm not sure if I've made potato. I made a lot of sausage.
And we have Missouri, West
Virginia. I'd like to know about that.
Yeah. Oregon.
Rogue River. Yeah, that's good area.
Couple in Missouri, and we are in Southwest Michigan, so we are going to be getting really cold here soon. Just to give you an update on, we'll come back to some of our topics here. Think of your questions. We'll come back to them as far as the Ask the Chef questions. We'll come back to them a little bit. Maybe we'll have to talk about that potato sausage.
Yeah, I'd like to know about that one. That's a new one to me.
Yeah. But I did want to let you guys know, we did get one video done this week. It took me actually 3 evenings to edit it because it was our entire weekend besides the beef butchery workshop at the Rhodes house. And this was 2 weeks ago. I know I'm behind on videos, but this was a lot of fun. We got to visit the farm. We got to hang out. We got to have a lot of good discussions back and forth. And where are we? We are in Southwest Michigan.
If that was directed towards us and not somebody else.
Yes. Usually all caps.
We're just outside of Kalamazoo.
Yeah.
Yes, real town.
So, yes, Kalamazoo's real. So we're in cold country. But we were in North Carolina 2 weeks ago, but we're back in Southwest Michigan now.
And you said that video was going pseudo-viral. Like, you got 1,000 hits last night out of random?
I got about 1,000 views on it within about 24 hours. Not the first 24 hours it went up, but the second 24 hours. The first 24 hours, I had about 400, which is, you know, on the
That's good.
Upper end of what we've been getting on, like, the first 24 hours of a video. But then it suddenly took off, and we had like 1,000 views in 24 hours. And
I've been busy all day. I haven't been really on the computer.
We've had a few more 100 views today, so I don't know what peaked yesterday. What happened with that?
Moving to Michigan, good. You're gonna love it. Where are you moving?
Oh, cool.
Hollers almost moved to Michigan. Rumor has it that was number 2. So they got beat out at last minute for North Carolina, which they're gonna enjoy.
Which I don't. I'm not horribly surprised.
And they're a little more. They're California, a little warmer, and Yeah. But anyways, Michigan has so much to offer. I've moved back here 4 times in my life, I guess, to Michigan.
Yeah, you probably
four
have.
Or 5 times back to Michigan.
I've lived in Michigan two separate spans, and we were in New York in between. So,
been all over the country, kind of.
Yeah, you have been a little bit more. I've traveled all over the country, but I haven't lived all over the country. But and Suburban Hillbillies posting some links. That's to Mike's pasta business.
Thank you. Yeah, we were packing. I just packed almost 200 packs of pasta. I have a friend over here who helps us, and we're getting ready for a major wine tasting charity event next Saturday and getting the scramble to get that ready.
Close nice. To UP.
I would love to go up further north.
I think it would be fun, but I'm not sure. I think I'd want summer cabins up north. We're in Southwest Michigan, so we're probably in about the warmest part of Michigan. Although
we get the lake, we get the lake.
We get a lake effect, and lake warmth, but we get lake effect snow.
Viral is your thing.
That's cool. Yeah. Well, that's a good place to start. 500 views
that's
on a
great.
Video.
That's
yeah.
Shoot, anybody gets 500 people to watch whatever silliness we're putting on. That's great.
Hi, Tina. Welcome.
How much snow are we expecting? We think we're in the, they're saying 4 to 8 inches.
Yeah.
It's been going up and down. East side of the state may be getting more like 1 foot. I haven't seen updates. So it's not a crazy storm, but it will be a nice snowfall. We got about 2 inches of really light snow last night. I plowed the driveway and I got the plow positioned and ready for tomorrow.
Probably about 5 or 6 inches on the ground right now.
I think a little more. No more? We're six-ish, seven, because we've gotten some light dustings, really powdery stuff. We plowed twice this week, so we got real snow. And then they're talking wind chills approaching minus 40, minus 50 in a few days, which we haven't seen in quite a few years. No. So don't be scared. That's not a normal thing.
No.
Just every
time. And we're in the warmest part of Michigan. Teasing.
Holland's nice. Holland's an hour-ish north of us.
North and east, west.
West, yeah, west.
On the lake.
Just over an hour. Really nice up there.
Yeah, it's gorgeous. The Tulip Festival, if you go up there during that time of year, it's fun.
Lois Ann says 10 to 12, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, so my phone right now is saying 7 inches tomorrow, 1 on Tuesday, and 2 on Wednesday on top of our whatever six inches.
Movement. Yep.
Yeah, so and on top of that freezing cold.
25, coldest in 25 years. That's what I remember. 93, I want to say that winter we had about a week and a half, 2 weeks where we were in sub-zero, I think, highs. We went for like 5 days where it was crazy cold. And so I was just finishing high school.
Yeah.
There are other times, but that was among the coldest long periods that I remember. Now my parents go back and say, what was it? The winter of 77. So I was 2 years old.
The year I was born.
Yeah. My brother.
No, it was the winter of 77. 77 to 78, my parents moved in that snowstorm. That was a blizzard. And
that was like
two
or three feet or something.
They had like, 2 to 3 feet at once, and they got their moving truck stuck at the bottom of the driveway, and their driveway's like a tenth of a mile long.
And it's flat, so it's hard to get.
Well, they have that ditch, so I'm wondering if they got ditched. But
so my parents told me there was both that, and that hit the whole Midwest and was massive amounts of snow. But my dad also tells me somewhere around that time, they had an ice storm that hit Ann Arbor where they got like 2 inches of ice, and they had to bring out the heavy equipment, earth moving equipment, and they were smashing ice with like backhoes and loaders because they couldn't melt it or plow anything.
Yeah.
I don't know if that was related to the storm or not, but I was about 2 years old, so I was born in 75, so
yeah,
don't remember it.
No. So yeah, that year was, I've heard stories. I don't remember that. I was a baby. But anyway, who saw the lunar eclipse last week our live show?
We got a really, it was cold and
I got
clear
a little picture of
and
it.
And no humidity because it was so cold. We got a really good view.
Yeah. Obviously, this isn't the full eclipse.
You stayed up a little late that night, I guess.
I did stay up a little late. I was supposed to go to bed after this. But hello, Green Gables. I have
information on making stock, which aka bone broth, in our new PDF, which is not up yet. Our beef packet PDF.
Yes.
On all kinds of information on butchering and understanding meat. I think we're going to post that soon. I think it's going to be like $14.
Yeah. So I just got to figure out how to put
I
that
do
on
have
page.
A recipe and a discussion, a moderately detailed discussion on making stock.
Yep.
And I could embellish that further with somebody as needed. So I was a saucier for a while, not as my full job, like a French style train, but I have more sauce training, traditional sauce training than most chefs. And that is one of sort of my preferred areas where people call on me when I'm working
to
do
saucier up at the Grand Hotel at Mackinac Island.
So that was early in my career, but my background, there's people who can do more sophisticated French classical work, but I'm in today's standards, I'm pretty good. I make very good stock, and then doing refined sauces, I'm pretty good on that. So happy to chat about that later.
Yeah. So anyway, I'm hoping some of you guys got out to see that last weekend. That was kind of cool to see the lunar eclipse. But this was our next morning. It was negative 14 on Monday morning, by the way, you guys. So this isn't our first bout of cold that we're getting, but it wasn't windy on Monday.
I don't think I left the house on Monday. I delayed stuff, errands till Tuesday because I had stuff I was doing here.
That was me doing the chicken chores.
Yeah, I made a lot of pasta on Monday.
So, I don't know how many of you guys got hit by the frigid weather last time on, I think it was Monday morning.
Yeah, it was cold.
And then, but this week it's supposed to be.
It fell off the shower. Were you delayed? Were you trapped or fixing it?
Oh no. But that negative 14, this is a heated dog water bowl, by the way, and it frosted up
I've seen that before.
So I've only seen it at the negative temperature, yeah. So we might get it.
It works
again.
Pretty well there.
It does. It does. The water in there is still liquid. The other one I have for Gus, obviously the water in there is dirty because we have geese. But high practical modern homestead. Hello, hello. But we have. The one I had for Gus had a little film of ice on the top, so we're going to have to watch that this week.
Well, one of them, Gus tore it apart. He ripped the cord out.
But we fixed it.
I tore it all apart and fixed it. You wanted to buy a new one. I'm like, I'm not buying a new one. I'm trying to fix it first. It's not high tech, and I
don't do electrical.
I rewired and resealed it with, and it seems to be doing great. So
we should have done a video on that.
Save some money on that
one. But, this is our base right now. Kind of a
and we have a quarter inch of ice on the driveway that we
everything
got
under.
Was that Tuesday, Monday night?
Tuesday to Wednesday.
It was hard, slick ice.
It basically, because Monday was cold, but Tuesday, Wednesday, I think it warmed up enough where everything
that's what it was.
Iced
it snowed
up
during
slicked.
Tuesday. So I couldn't plow it. I mean, my plow blade, I just have a feet. It doesn't plow all the way to the surface. So it doesn't do any good. I can run out. I tried.
Thanks,
for
random
a moment,
mini
friend. I can't scrape it off, but I've got enough snow on it. It's fine now.
Come here. I don't know if you can see her. Nope, the chair's in the way. She's asleep on the couch right now.
She's very sleepy. Oh, there she goes.
Hi, Puddin.
Heads up.
Yeah. So, So it's cold and snowy.
House is
week.
Warm. We got the fire going, and
yes.
The furnace is doing its thing. And my pasta kitchen downstairs is 55 degrees, which is actually cool, but that's why I'm
not
a little
bad.
Bundled up. It's when I'm making pasta, it's great. It's not bad for packaging. I'd rather have it cool. It's good.
Yeah.
Good for the pasta.
So and then we have I'm thinking about this. Oh, at least every time you make a new type of sourdough, he made more sourdough this week. And do you want to explain what type of sourdough
I finished it last night. So that's still using an all rye sourdough starter from Stefan, which is one of the best sourdough starters. I worked with a few. It's a very slow acting, so it doesn't get real bubbly. It's pretty sour and balanced, and it's based on an all rye. So rye ferments and flavors differently. It just biologically is different activity when it makes a sourdough than an all wheat sourdough.
Yeah.
But it's very good sourdough starter. And so it's a classic pre-ferment, and I retard overnight after I make it. So that one is half rye, half 6-grain, multigrain. The multigrain, I think the first ingredient is probably whole wheat. And it's probably got some more rye in it. And then I'd have to look at what else was in it. I buy it in bulk. So it's a half 6-grain, primarily rye sourdough. It takes 2.5 days to make it, so it really breaks down nice. And then Cindy got me a stone for Christmas, which I hadn't had in a long time, so we just have a regular old standard crappy oven. But you can make good bread in a crappy oven if you have a stone or a hard heat sink for it. And then if you throw ice in the bottom, you can get the steam, which causes the oven spring and the glazing over. You can get a pretty nice, super expensive high oven response with ice. Now, eventually, if you throw enough ice down there, you may start to rust out the bottom if you're doing it too often, but it's not a big deal.
Can you put it on
oven.
A pantry underneath that? Or
I guess you could, yeah. And then, so what I got was some of the baskets, proofing baskets, which I've never had.
So that's
since
why
professional
it's
classes. So the proofing baskets have that cane look to them, and then they have an optional canvas baggie. So if you want more of a cane look, you flour the cane and you press it and you let it rise in there. If you want a little bit less or a moderate, you use the canvas. The canvas is nice because it doesn't stick.
All right.
And so you heavily flour it. You just keep the flour in there, you just keep dust it out. Whenever you need to, as long as it doesn't grow mold or do something nasty, you just leave it alone. And so it proofs in there because this is a real high hydration. It's a 77% hydration,
mm-hmm.
Which means there's 77% water to 100% flour. Gives it really nice texture, but it's hard to handle. It's too soft to handle. So you can't, once it's gone from proof, it's going through the proofing, you can't handle it to get it onto the pan or onto a peel. So when you use a proofing basket, not only do you get the nice shape, you can roll it out carefully from top goes to the bottom.
Yeah.
And then the canvas will allow it to release. And because it's heavily floured, you get what's called the rustic style boules, the rounds, or the bastons or batons,
which
the
are
long
ones.
And when you have that specific flour on top, semolina or regular flour, aside from it kind of looking nice in contrast, that would be a rustic loaf.
Yeah.
So that's what it is. And they came out really good. They're on the denser side because of all the whole grain. And the crumb structure is small, but it's really tasty.
I haven't done bread in the toaster oven. We do have a bread maker as well, but we've pretty much stopped using it since you started making all these sourdoughs.
My alternative is when I'm busy is to throw it in the bread maker. Now mm-hmm. the crumb structure and the pre-ferment. And so I can't get rising fast enough with the sourdough because it's slow acting. So you don't get the full breakdown of the grains and the full flavor development. But if you want to, it's a little cheaper than bought bread, but not much. But what you can do is control the grain. So if you want high quality grain or you want organic or whatever it is, you know, and if you want to sweeten with maple or brown
molasses,
sugar or molasses or raw sugar.
Yeah. You can use
and
whatever.
You want to use butter or milk, you know every ingredient that goes in there. So it's not about really saving money, but you get a great loaf of bread.
I call it soup permaculture.
And then it takes care of itself cooking. And it's not a beautiful loaf, but it's a high quality loaf.
Yeah.
The next step, which I haven't done in a lot of years, is starting to play with the sourdoughs again. But that requires I go through these longer ferments. I could throw it in the bread maker to cook it off. But that's silly. Once I've gone to all the work, I might as well.
Yeah.
Bake it in an oven. I have an oven down in my pasta shop, so I can kind of attend to it while doing other things, which is working out good. And then I just bought the proofing baskets.
Do you want to grab one and show?
Oh yeah, that'd be fun. And there, I got them online for like $14, I think.
Yeah. So I actually gave him for Christmas. I gave him a baking stone for the oven, which he hadn't had before, and he kept complaining whenever he made the sourdough bread that he couldn't get the right crust on it. You really need a baking stone. Yeah, he kept burning the bottom of it. And then, so I got him that, but then I didn't get him the baskets, although I did look at them briefly.
In my theory on the bread, because I trained with a bunch of older European bread bakers, I had limited bread classes I'm a traditional savory chef. So I enjoy baking. I'm better than the average chef at baking and okay with bread because I enjoy it and I paid attention to it and wanted to be decent at it, but it's not my daily by any means. I can just pull off some decent stuff. So I like it quite crusty and dark because I learned a lot from the older European guys. They like them almost to the point of what we think of as burned because of the contrast on a white loaf that's so crusty and almost burned on the outside like a baguette, and then big holes and soft and rich and a little bit sweet. Flavor from the middle, that's the perfect contrast. Same with the croissant, it should be very dark and it's not. So that's a personal preference.
Yeah, let's get.
So this is a traditional proofing basket. It's made out of like a wood cane. And then it has and these I found online, Amazon or something, eBay, about $14. You can pay more for them. If you bought them in tons of them, you can probably get them cheaper. So this is like a wicker, actually. This is very much like your wicker, so very traditional.
Yeah.
So you could actually flour this and use this. And then you have a canvas little sack that comes with it, which is floured. And then you just keep the flour on it. You can knock it out and dust out as much as you want. This was the first time I floured it, so I used a bunch. I did want it a little more rustic. And then this is...
That's the long one, yeah.
This will hold a 1 kilo loaf, so 2.2 pounds. This one, you could probably get, you can do a 2 pound. You can also get away with like a 4 pound, which is a medium sized boul, a two kilo. A 4 kilo is your really big classic bowls. And they incidentally rise and perform differently. I think their flavor is better. I never make them that big because we wouldn't eat it before it went bad. But I think in restaurants that are doing that really dark rustic boul, the really big ones that are 4 or 5 kilos, the way it all mechanically and biologically works provides a more complex finished product, but they're all very good.
We're going to have to add those. I mean, we have in our link in our description, we have a link to our kit page, which lists a lot of different things in different categories that we use. We're going to have to add some of this stuff to that.
So two other options. So my cuts on, so buying bread is fine. Buying good bread is nice. Using a cheap, $30 to $50 bread maker is a really great way. Even if you're just buying average flours, nice flours. And I kind of like the King Arthur stuff. And I like some of the other stuff. But you don't have to get crazy. It's still going to be better than most. The next step is you can also make your basic breads. And I like making oatmeal bread in there and things. It's like an oatmeal white.
You should do a video on that.
That you can always knock them out and you can bake them in an oven if you want a better loaf. So these guys, if you're doing any baking in an oven, having a couple of these guys around really helps your final product, even though it's the same product, all of a sudden looks so professional because it shapes nice and it rolls out nice and all that.
Yeah.
So if you're serious about making bread and you're going to do it more than once or twice a month or more, it might be fun to spend $14 I bought two rounds and I bought one of the long ones. I figured that was a reasonable amount to be able to, that's going to cover anything that I'm making in any normal circumstance. So
I think you had two long ones.
No, I got one long and two rounds.
Anyway, so
that was my Christmas present to me.
That was your own Christmas present. The baking stone was part of my Christmas present to you.
So they're working pretty good.
Yeah. And there's a lot of people talking about bread making and stuff and wanting to make better breads and all that. Going to have to
Don't overthink it. If you can't pull off
just play.
Making bread, because I didn't make bread for years. I've been home a little more, just doing other things, but I have more access to stop for a moment and do stuff.
Ellen.
I think the bread maker is the key if you want to save a little money or step away from buying some breads. Just start with that. There is a book, by the way.
Teresa.
Oh, I have it in the cabinet that Cindy got. I think it's amazingly good bread making book.
He'll go on about bread for a while. But no, you could bring back some bread too. That would be a nice snack. No. And we'd tease you with it.
And I buy the 25-pound bags and 50-pound bags of flour because they're so cheap. Now, it can take a while. They'll eventually go rancid in 6 years or 6 months to white bread or white flour in like a year. But you can buy really good flour, and it's like $20. When you realize that 50 pounds, all of a sudden you knock the bottom. What's expensive is the maple or the molasses and the honey. And if you use real butter, that's the expensive part of the bread. So this is a book that Cindy got years ago, and I've poked through it, and I've made a number of the recipes. The Bread Lovers Bread Machine Cookbook. Beth Hensberger is a James Beard Award-winning book. It's been out for quite a while. She is a very legitimate, very good bread baker, way beyond what I do. Well, she converted some of her best recipes
to work for
a bread maker.
Yeah.
I got to tell you, the little bread maker books that come with it, the recipes are terrible. They do not come out very good. They're not well-balanced. Her recipes are really good, really intimate, and they really work in a bread maker. Not like you rolled it out as a loaf, but they're really nice. So two secrets that I use. Any advice on how to make
bread in a toaster oven?
You can make a loaf, and it depends on the toaster oven model a lot. I would get the temperature settled first, because that on-off can give it kind of scorch it. Because it's intense on and intense off, but smaller loaves are better.
Yeah. I would guess mini loaves or something.
Yeah. Two quick things I would do is, so she recommends, she adds gluten to almost all of her recipes because she doesn't know what the quality of your flour is. So instead of trying to figure out how much water and how much you get things, she always adds a modest amount of gluten, which means you're always in a high gluten bread, which then means you're going to get good performance results. Now, if you're buying good flour, you can choose not to add that gluten or add less to it because you've already got it naturally developed. But there was something else I was going to say about? Oh, the other thing I use to cut a lot of corners is I buy 10-grain and 6-grain breakfast cereal, in the grain section, the Anson Mills or the Bob's Red Mill stuff. It says breakfast cereal. Some of you got to cook out. Some I just add a little extra water and give it extra time. So if I want to make a complex 10 grain, instead of having all that stuff and blending it, which is impossible, buying the little flax seeds, and it adds up. It's so overpriced. Yeah. And then you don't use it in proportion. Well, if you take the 10 grain and then you add a little bit of rye to it and a little bit of this, all of a sudden you've got like a 12 grain bread that you can pull off, and you do a cup of, you know, half a cup of the 10 grain and, you know, half a cup of this and your white flour. And before you know it, you've got a pretty darn nice, quick thing. We do make our own maple syrup.
Yeah.
Started doing that last year. Maple syrup is really expensive to be putting in your bread, putting a quarter cup or a half cup of maple in there. Let me tell you.
Although we don't go through our maple syrup.
We've been going through it slow, and a lot of it's crystallized into candy. So I need to put more into the bread, because now, instead of being this, ooh, don't touch it, it's really expensive, it's like we have it, aside from the time to boil it down, we have it available. It's okay to use it in some bread.
Yeah. So, and what we'll do is we'll go on to next segment here as he's walking off again. But every week or almost every week.
Don't forget the salt in the bread. It tastes terrible.
Oh, you have to put the salt in the bread.
It tastes terrible.
Yeah.
You can cut it by half, but don't leave it out completely. It stays so bland.
You forgot it last week.
It goes into the second step on this stuff, so you don't kill the yeast. And I knew it was too late. You can't put it in late either. It's after a point. I made it into bread pudding. We made it into savory bread pudding, which we did an Instagram shot. That was really good with turkey and some cream and some eggs and some herbs. We saved a good-looking but not great-tasting loaf and turned it into bread pudding.
So I just want to let you know what I've been working on today is on our webpage for the Part-Time Permies webpage, which is linked in the description below. We have a whole list of links in the description here. So actually what I did do is just copy a link to today's feature. We have a little blog going on there that I try to keep up to date weekly, although we do miss a few weeks here or there. Focusing primarily on foraged items, but sometimes herbs you can grow and what you can use them for and things like that medicinally or cooking related. So I was working on the page and actually trying to create a index of everything, because I think we've had got to be over 40 different things that we featured. Some of these are mushrooms too. So different foraged items, different herbs and things you can use. So if you check out that link that I just posted, that goes directly to this week's.
Hey, we're going to get colder than Saskatchewan this week.
Yeah, probably.
No, we don't have an evaporator or Kalamazoo permaculture. I have a couple big 4 and 5 gallon pots that I've used for beer. We've used for scalding chickens. I just bought a 100-quart pot that's coming in. Got it really cheap, $60. I hope it's aluminum, not steel. Hopefully I need a bigger pot for from stock and some other things, scalding. And
thanks, Carrie.
So we don't have an evaporator. Mike Pratt made a really nice evaporator, pretty inexpensive.
Yes,
I think he has videos from last winter.
Pratt family Homestead. It was his very first video of his whole channel was on making.
He scorched a batch. I scorched a batch. I set off all the fire alarms in the house. Had a cloud of smoke. Because there's this very fine point on.
Yeah, you got to watch it.
After you reduce it by 40 to 1.
Yeah.
And I know better because I made all kinds of caramels. I just missed it. But we're simmering it down in the house, which is terrible because the amount of electricity it uses and time and then all
the
humidity.
Moisture.
I do have a candy stove burner, like a propane burner. That's the preferred. The problem being, one, you have to watch it outside, and I'm concerned about scorching the bottom because I have a medium aluminum pot and I have a thin steel pot, and you really need to get.
Can you do it on the towel? Like put that in between?
Yeah, but that's still going to get super hot. I need to buffer that heat, but ideally it should be done on propane, much cheaper, and get the humidity out. It was not the smartest way. But we only did, we got about a gallon yield, over a gallon yield, all said and done for the year.
Yeah. So, okay. So we're going to go on to, it's not featured forage food this week. It's more of a herb of the week like I used to do last winter, because I'm out of featured foraged items that I can come up with for the winter time, which there are some things out there, but we've already featured them. So This was taken last June of our lavender, one of our two plants out there. And that is the feature for this week. Basically going by what I have pictures of still. So I might be slowing down on some of this for the end of winter until we get
sub-zero, until we get a little break in it.
Until we start getting into early spring again. But lavender is one of my favorite herbs. I do have it. For those of you guys who are here earlier, I actually have it on the teapot on our fireplace right now just for the scent. And that's my main use of it. Can drink it in tea and things as well. I don't know how many of you guys grow lavender, use lavender, if you have uses that you have that you use it for, or if you use it in cooking and different dishes.
Stick it in my underwear drawer, of course.
Well, you could do that. You could also stick it in your linens closet so you make your sheets and things smell like lavender. I think that would actually be nicer. But you can use it for potpourri and perfume. Oh, blanking on words today. But but yeah, if you want to go ahead as I'm chatting and list whatever things you use your lavender for, or whether it's just for
pretty flowers.
Well, you
can cook with it too.
You can cook with it.
There's a few things you can cook
with it. So, by the way, I'm going to start with where it grows. I have this pulled up on my phone, so I don't have to flip around.
Our hugel culture is where it grows.
Right now, it grows on our hugel culture bed at the top of it because it likes well-drained soil. So the bottom of the bed actually holds more moisture.
It kind of likes some sun and some heat.
It likes the sun. It's a Mediterranean plant, so it does like sun, well-drained soil, and some heat. Although it'll grow up to zone 5, so zones 5 through 8. There you go, and soaps. I didn't even put that
soap
in.
Soap is, yeah. Yeah. Green Gables, yeah, so lavender is a little picky to start, but once it sets in, it's unless you get something crazy. When you get super cold windblown areas, you can knock it out, but generally it survives the winter. Yeah. And once it establishes, it really goes to town. And yeah, in Texas, super hot in Texas, you might have killed it.
Something interesting that I learned that I forgot to put in the blog, but was that if you have seeds and you try to grow lavender from seeds, it takes about 3 weeks to germinate, and they don't germinate at very high rates. You get maybe maximum of 50% germination on lavender seeds. And so they're really hard to start from seed, but once you have them established, you can split them. So we only have two plants right now. I think maybe
they're really effective splitting.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think maybe this next year, the bigger plant, I'll be able to split. It took a couple years to get them established. One of our plants is, I have to keep our spearmint from overrunning it, but might have to move it. We'll have to see. But yeah, so we use it there. And it does grow.
You can grow it potted also.
You can grow it potted. Once it gets going, it goes well.
Yeah.
Texas might be a little bit hot for it.
Out in direct. So typically it likes a direct sun. But in Texas, I would watch the water a little bit on it. Well drained, but give it a little water. And I might actually want to shield it into partial sun to take out some extreme heats. Because it grows really well in the Mediterranean and Provence.
Yep.
In parts of France, in the warmer parts, but Texas might be pushing it.
In fact, Provence, France is actually where they have fields and fields of lavender they cultivate it. That's where they get most of the oil extract.
Some big commercial lavender farms in Michigan.
We
too.
Do.
One right down the road from us, a new one.
Oh yeah.
There's Lavender Labyrinth, which is all kinds of herbs and bazillion things and a big kind of tourist attraction. But there's a new one at the end of our little village just opened last year.
Okay.
And I haven't been past it, but I know where it's at.
Check it out. Yeah, so culinary, it's in Herbes de Provence. Well, at least in the American version of it. Apparently the French version of it didn't originally have lavender.
Really?
I read anyway. That also has savory, marjoram, rosemary. Thyme and oregano.
We have lavender oil put in our chicken feed. Our local mill, which Cindy plans to do a video with him.
Yeah.
She was sick and had to cancel it quite a while ago this spring. Last winter, fall, whatever it was. He grinds his own feed and he adds essential oils, orange oil, lavender oil, I think something else,
mm-hmm.
to fortify and to calm the poultry.
Yeah.
How good is that for a local feed mill? And
not just that. Okay, I'll come back to culinary, but medicinally, yes, it's a relaxant, gentle sedative. So people use it to help sleep. Put a couple drops of lavender oil in a bath before bed. It should help relax you. It does have a lot of studies on its anti-anxiety effects. So if you have clinical anxiety, or just anxiety in general, it does help. Most of those studies were comparing to placebo. So I don't know in comparison to other medications for anxiety. Of course, I always say whatever works best for the person. Mild antidepressant, antimicrobial. So using it in salves for skin scratches and things like that, burns, which I actually burned my hand on the stove on the fireplace back here today. So traditionally used to treat headaches. Now this is one thing I have not found. I do get migraines myself, and I don't find anything scented to work for my migraines. In fact, it tends to agitate me. So but they're supposed to be good for headaches, including migraines. Might work for some people better than others, I guess. What else do we have here? Soothe indigestion and gas and bloating. So some people use it in tea after dinner, kind of like your mint teas and things like that as well. Has been, I already said, antiseptic for burns, wounds, and sores. And can also be used to relieve pain of insect stings and bites. So pain and inflammation. So a lot of medicinal things. I was just trying to see if I missed some of that. Yeah.
Using it for couple deodorant. Drops.
Yeah. Couple drops of small.
Lavender oil is a very strong oil, both in flavor, yes, it is. And it's very concentrated. So a little goes a long ways. In fact, overdoing it is very easy. So
your chickens ate all your lavender that you had in pots.
Yeah, I think it's great for the chickens, actually. Yeah. There's a lot of talk about growing excess herbs to feed to your livestock.
Yes.
When it makes them their meat taste better, but their general health, feeding to the goats and we don't have goats, but no. Goats and sheep, but definitely poultry. So growing an excess of thyme and lavender and you know, a whole variety of things. Birds won't eat every herb, but they'll eat a lot of them. So that's a great idea if you can afford the space to.
And I've just started looking at this. I haven't read it through and through, but Amy Fuel's book, The Homesteader's Herbal Companion, has some of that information in there too, various ways to use different herbs, but including using them on the livestock and things, at least some basics. So that is a good book. I need to put that book, because we got it just this fall, I need to put it in our kit. Culinary uses, someone already said, like in honey, you can use crystallize it in sugar, you can put it in jams and syrups and vinegars. You can use it to garnish some teas and lemonade or whatnot for the flowers. Most of the time you're picking the flowers, by the way, when you harvest them, you want to pick
them.
It's
a wand.
What?
It's a lavender wand.
Lavender wand. Or a spike.
Spike, yes. Some as lavender wands culinarily for garnish.
Yes. Yeah, so if you want to pick them and at their strongest amount of oil, you actually want to pick them one in the early morning, but you want to pick the ones that are just starting to open.
Yeah.
You don't want to pick the ones that are already open, because the strongest oils are going to be the ones that are just about to open. Oh, cookies. I didn't have that on there.
What's that? Putting them in cookies?
I don't know. I haven't seen them in cookies.
I have seen them in cookies. I've seen them in like shortbread cookies.
I've seen them in pound cake. Lemon pound cake. Lemon lavender pound cake.
I have not seen lavender pound cake.
Yeah.
I've done a lot of things with it. But cookies, yes, I've seen them in butter cookies. Pound cake would be fine.
Used with other fresh herbs and vinaigrettes. That's sparingly, one thing, yes. They were. Yeah, it is strong, so you want to use a little bit. And there are some places that use it to flavor cheese. Which I haven't tried that, but yeah, there's a lot of places that put herbs in cheese.
So herbs of Provence is basically wild herbs that would grow. So it's in the marjoram and later oregano, savory, which I love.
And thyme.
And different types of wild thymes. And so frequently, Herbes de Provence will have lavender in that.
Green Gables, that is Curie.
Yeah, it's Curie. Curie changed her name.
Yep.
And so you can buy the plain lavender pods.
Lavender crepes?
Yeah, that would be fun. In fact, so what you can do with the pods is then you can put them in as needed. We used to do a lot of lavender chicken. So it was black pepper, lemon zest, mm-hmm. lavender, and we would grill the chicken. We did that for tons of ladies' golf events. You do have to be careful because when you're grilling it, you intensify it. Yeah. You can overdo it. There are people that do not care for it. It's sort of like mint. It's very menthol-y. It's very...
Yeah, it is. It's in the same family.
Yeah, it's very aggressive.
As mint and oregano and savory. Those are all really in the same.
Very resinous. So you can do it like that. You can use it in your ratatouilles and things where you do herbs for Provence seasoning and roasts. Yes, lavender jelly, which is going to be primarily other items with a little bit of lavender in it, like an apple jelly.
Yeah.
And that's nice garnish for things. And you can add other herbs and citrus. It's good for doing creme brulees, going sweet instead of savory. So you steep the lavender in cream, and you make a custard or a creme brulee, and you can then flavor it heavily with vanilla or orange lavender, things like that. Very, very tasty if you have it in balance.
Mm-hmm.
And
but it's strong, so you have to...
It can taste like soap. As it gets strong, and because soap uses it a lot, that's when I back way off of it.
It can have a bit of a bitter...
Yeah, eating whole lavender pods is intense. So. And I've done that because I've cooked with it enough. I like to do roasted potatoes with a touch of lavender. So your garlic or onion, salt and pepper, aggressive, you know, sea salt and cracked pepper. If you want to put some other, toss them in herbs, like a red skin potato where you roast them out. Touch of lavender, and that is actually very nice. Again, go easy, even with potatoes that are so starchy. So.
Yeah, I've removed a wound from her arm. I think that's supposed to be, would put lavender on the wounds, and the doctor was amazed how fast it was healing.
I'm sure it's fairly antiseptic. It is. Yeah.
Everything in that family.
Yeah, lavender panna cotta, lavender citrus, lavender vanilla panna cotta, or custard. Excellent choice. Thyme, by the way, almost any of your herbs can be put into a panna cotta or a creme brulee. And when you switch it from savory to sweet, people don't recognize it. They're like, this is good. And they have no idea. Basil, whatever.
Lavender infused potatoes.
Yeah, the roasted potatoes. Yes. Yeah. Or other types of potatoes. So, but you are going to have people that have no interest in it, no matter how you prepare it and how little. So just be aware that it may not be a crowd pleaser for everybody. But I think if you play with it carefully, and then the lavender wands, which are small, but when they're just beginning to open up, they're frequently used as a garnish. There's a non-edible, but so it's debatable, but they're a nice plate garnish or a platter garnish on a cheese board or sticking behind,
say,
a piece of roasted duck.
If you're putting it in herbal tea, you might be adding some flavor to your tea.
If you're putting it in tea, you could steep the wand.
Yeah.
But even you can also create a scent. So say you put it in behind a roasted duck, a half roasted duck, and you're getting that lavender smell, but you're not actually eating it.
Lavender, little bits. When you say a little lavender, you mean...
I'm talking a few pods, pinches, a few pieces. Yeah, yeah, far from teaspoons.
Yes,
like pounds of chicken marinated with teaspoons in total.
Pounds of chicken.
And I'm talking commercial prep. Yeah, I had 1 pound containers of, you know, those
house
sleeves.
Prep though. House prep, because most people
pinches.
You just
and start with a little, and if you like it, do a touch more. Too little is never going to be the problem. So start with that and then add to it,
because it's strong.
Yeah, and if you marinate, the longer the marinade, the more the oils will penetrate and overtake it. So that's even more so. But yeah, play with it. I think it's an amazingly fun ingredient that is limitedly used in food, and I'm sure that it has some general nutraceutical, medicinal, small amounts of eating more than in your diet isn't all bad.
There weren't a whole lot of big studies or, but there were some people that were starting to look into lavender oil as well as some
lavender
other oils.
Honey is beautiful too, by the way, just steeping the wands in the honey.
But as far as like anti-Alzheimer's and dementia type and focus and people who took oral lavender actually had better focus longer term than those who did not. So it, they were really saying? Preliminary. Do we need to give it to someone who's a little ADD here? No. Okay. So we
are lavender and cocktails, by the way, also infusing liqueurs and liqueurs, oh, sure. Or making an upstyle cocktail and dressing it up with a little dash of a wand.
Yeah.
Or a lavender simple syrup. Again, super, go super light and pair it with other flavors and citruses and things. But you can
pinch or
pinches
smidges.
And smidges. Yeah. Yeah. That's in that category.
Okay.
It's a fun playground. If you're into cooking and playing around a little bit, especially when you have some fresh come midsummer, it's great.
Okay. So we are going to move on to our next section, which is still cooking related. We do this every week for those of you guys who are new. It's an ask the chef
that was
question.
A good plate. We pulled that one out of our rear end.
Just a second. What I'm going to say is while he explains the dish, you can start thinking of questions to ask him, any cooking questions you want, and start putting them,
Yes, that's correct.
Yes. Putting them in caps would help because then we could see if you guys are chatting with each other or with us, but we'll try to look for any questions. So while they're thinking of their cooking questions, what is in that picture? What did we have? You gonna explain it now?
That's lapin.
Lapin. What is lapin? No French.
Yeah, that is my French is terrible, but I do know some culinary French. Rear end.
No. what is in it?
Lapin is rabbit.
We got that locally.
Yes. No buckshot in it. It's a backyard rabbit, like a backyard chicken. I have a friend who buys pasta from me who raises backyard rabbits. And we've traded and secured private transactions to acquire some of her extra rabbits in the prepared state. And she does a nice job. Yeah, it's so interestingly, I don't know.
We had duck a week ago.
We did because I got
2 weeks ago.
$2.25 duck at Aldi's, frozen ducks. They still have them there. I was over there last week.
Well, this week was rabbit.
Yeah, and so, Kyle, we've been eating kind of good in the winter.
Yeah.
So we did a roasted instead of braised. And so I was given this rabbit that was clean. And so it's probably primarily grain-fed, but it's a backyard rabbit, and they're really well taken care of. So let me tell you, you can find rabbit in the frozen section at a lot of grocery stores. You'd be surprised. They're going to be in a little bag, and they're all curled up. And they, once you cut part of them out, they don't look too much different than a chicken in pieces. In fact, you can sell the rabbit. You can serve rabbit and just tell people it's chicken and they'll probably eat it. The problem being commercial rabbit is fed on grain and it is so lean. There's no fat on it. And it's so mild. It toughens up and it just tastes like a really bad chicken that you paid too much money for it.
Ask the chef question. We'll come back to it in a second.
So I would dissuade you from buying the frozen rabbits in the grocery store because I am always disappointed the few times I've bought them. But if you really want to play with it, it is a lean meat. They overcharge in stores because people don't buy a lot of them. However, if you do backyard rabbits, we are told that they're much easier to skin. They don't smell like chicken, which has this particular smell when you clean it, which some people don't like. They won't eat you and peck you alive if you die. As we were told, if you ever fall down and knock your head out, your chickens will kill you. Your rabbits will do nothing. But they eat about the same amount of grain, and they do not stink if they're properly taken care of. They make great fertilizer, and you can they're raised very quickly on a minimum amount of food. So in amongst the categories like chicken, they are one of the best returns on grain to protein or grasses to protein. So we don't grow them, but if you're ever thinking about it, they're supposed to be great for backyard projects, and they don't make any noise. So I love chicken, but not fond of rabbit.
She raises rabbits, but wanted
really?
Some.
Yeah, and then wild rabbit, which I've only had once, can be quite strong because of all the grasses and twigs and herbs de Provence that it's eating or whatever. They can be quite variable from meadow to strong. And I had a friend who goes, oh, we killed some in the winter, the farmer. And he goes, golly, they taste like cherry bark. It was terrible because there was no food and they were gnawing on all the fruit wood bark as a kind of last resort. You can skin a rabbit because it sheds off super easy, which is the advantage over chicken plucking.
We don't raise rabbits ourselves. We got this from a friend. So we wouldn't know about all the different
breeds. She raises a giant rabbit breed, which is common. She has a cross of a giant and a something because...
Rabbits rip up your arms. Those nails are sharp.
Yeah, well, that So we don't have a lot of experience, but we have had a number of friends. And somebody goes to Homesteaders America from Michigan. And I always forget their name. Does classes on rabbit raising and cleaning. Oh, yeah, on
the east side of the state.
I always forget their name. I forget. Nice family.
Yes.
They have... The poo is perfect for
fertilizer.
Poopalizers, yes.
Foodalizers?
Foodalizers, because it's not hot. Like you can use it right away. And they don't carry salmonella and some of the things that you have to be a little more careful with
chicken
poultry. Too. So, any event, wild rabbits can taste strong and funny. So, understand that they're gamey. So, these giant rabbits that are backyard fed and raised are kind of the best of all. So they're a little more exercised and meaty. They ranged about 2.5 pounds dressed. And
Susie, what kind of rabbits do you have? What breeds?
Yeah. You know more than we do, but.
Yeah. And then what else do you have on the dish? Because it was completely local.
So this was fun. So I had the rabbits that I had a trade deal set up. I ended up with more than I thought. I was looking for just like two or maybe three, and I ended up with four. So I gave one to a close friend who would appreciate it, who trades stuff with us. And then I put two in the freezer. So I have some beans that I cooked out. They are flageolet, which, by the way, is a very fancy French bean, typically used for cassoulet.
Hi, that 1870 Somerset. Also, Rachel? Okay, keep going.
Yeah, no, that's fine. So flageolet, very fancy French bean. You pay a good amount of money. By the way, flageolet beans, your green beans, when they mature and you forgot to pull them out of your garden, you're missing a few. The Angora rabbits, yeah. You can, if you take the seeds and you dry them, that is actually your French flageolet beans. So they're not as fancy as people make them out to be, but they are a prized, who knew that the green bean is a prized dried legume?
And you also had...
I didn't know that for a long time, and I was cooking flageolets.
What else did we have with that?
So I had the flageolets from Shadyside Farm, which is an organic, local, awesome farm that raises lamb and beans and a little bit of beef. I have the rabbit, which I roasted very similar to a chicken. Fresh and dry herbs, salt and pepper. Roasted it for about an hour, just like a chicken, until it was tender and, you know, yielding at the bone. You have two parts. You have the back legs, which are the large parts, about the same size as a small chicken thigh. And then you have the front legs, which are small, and restaurants sometimes cut them off and make sauce with them. But I think they're totally edible. And then you have the loin. So you'll have a loin that's about that big on the inside, outside, and then on the inside you have the tenderloin. So that's desirable. That's very tender and can be grilled. You don't necessarily have to braise it or roast it. And then you have a little bit of rib and flat meat, which is not much of anything on there, good for sauce or just kind of gnawing on it.
Yeah.
Half a rabbit of that size per person is the right portion, for sure. You need a decent amount. Yeah, she uses a giant Rex and I forget the other one. So Shadyside beans. Oh, I had a Napa cabbage from the farmer's market from Bon Amigo. Okay. I had some kimchi from a friend that makes it and gives it to us.
Yeah.
I quick sauteed the Napa cabbage. I had a touch of, I didn't even have any ginger, which is common with rabbit. I had some of the kimchi juice, a touch of gochujang, which is Korean chili paste. So it was sort of like fresh Napa and pickled Napa. And I just added the kimchi in at the end just to warm it. Mm. And so I had the beans, the roasted rabbit, and then I had, I took the juices, that kind of kimchi juice, gochujang kimchi juice, and I just poured it around the back. So that was starch, veg, and protein. And it plates out. And then you kind of get a nice jus. Oh, and I put a little... Oh, I buttered the beans. So the beans I cooked out in some dried thyme, salt, pepper. I think it was just water. And then at the end, I threw a big, like an ounce of butter in there for a pound of beans. 1.5 ounces of butter. So I really buttered them out. And so you have these buttery beans and then the kimchi, slightly spicy, cabbagey, stir-fry slaw. Juice naturally came out, and it made, honestly, that is a restaurant plate I could sell for $29, $32 in New York, $26 here. I totally could sell that plate for good money, and that was totally local, healthy, great stuff, and I just pulled together, like, what do we have, what to go with the rabbit? I'm like,
boom. Okay. So that was our dinner earlier this week.
Tuesday night?
Yeah.
Monday, Tuesday night.
The other thing, I think I only saw it because that stimulated some discussions in there, but
yeah.
I only saw one question come through from the white picket fence. They want to salt water ferment veggies, but don't like the sour taste.
Well, would it salt hurt? Water shouldn't cause a souring. Yeah. Salt water is a brine.
Yeah.
So it will dehydrate, it will season and it will dehydrate, and it will soften because of the collapsing
but
of the cells.
But will you get the lack of ferment?
No, not in, well, eventually, so salt retards fermentation,
yeah.
But at the right balance, at a low brine, you can actually kimchi from horse manure.
What?
No, I don't think so. Maybe.
Unless you're growing cabbage out of your,
yeah,
your aged horse manure.
Now you can get kimchi. Now you can get kimchi from manure. So using brining to soften or prepare or lightly wilt things is an awesome idea, and it's very trendy in raw food preparations. The lacto ferment takes time to develop, and you retard it depending on how much salt. You need to retard the yeast. So the yeast will outstrip the lactobacillus, but you're not technically pickling. So what you can also, by the way, if you don't like pickled vegetables because they're too vinegary, you can counteract that with sugar, sweet, you know, some form of a sweet item. So you get a sweet and sour, and you can actually bring the sugar level very high, and that will counteract a lot of the sour. You can also rinse them, but the probiotic, if you're doing a raw ferment, is good for you, but flavor-wise, don't worry about it if you don't want it.
Yeah.
Or you can blend it. In this case where we used the kimchi, which was a fresh, moderately fermented kimchi, but we added only a quarter kimchi and the rest was fresh Napa.
Yeah.
There's also something you can look up. It's called a nokoduko.
How do you spell that?
Noka, I think.
N-O-K-A?
N-O-C-A, N-O-K, duko. It's Japanese, and it uses barley, brown rice bran, which is a little hard to find, and it uses a lot of salt, and you create a culture that's a culture that lives on the bran, is retarded by the high salt and a little bit of water, and it looks like a wet sand slurry. And what you do is, but you now you've got a bacteriologic, and a lot of times you add a koji, which is a mushroom-based, fungus-based cure. And so you have this kojis are used for sake and for making some of the mushroom ferments and things, and a lot of new stuff going into looking at that. So the nokoduko is this balance, sort of like a SCOBY, which is a scary thing to me. It's like, you know, it's this yeast bacteria biologically balanced, keeping it in balance type thing, and then you make stuff with it. So you take this. Yeah, we're going to look up the spelling on it.
Yeah, I'm trying to find it. Nukadoko?
Yeah, that's probably it. Yeah, I'd say that's.
There's a few options.
And so it's this slushy, sandy-looking thing, and you bury hard fruits, unripe fruits, or vegetables in it for a period of hours.
Fermented rice bran. Yeah.
Yeah. And what it does is the salting extracts liquid and softens it. The koji and the bacteria in it create a quick fermentation. And so you get a pickling, fermenting of these vegetables, and then you pull them out and you eat them. And I had a friend try and make it, but we didn't have the right bran. We tried it with something else. And the one caveat is I would be very scared of it because you don't know what the yeast is unless you start a culture, proper culture, and you're maintaining it. You need to be an advanced, fermentology person. Otherwise, I mean, warning, this could kill you if you screw it up it could get weird. You could end up in the hospital with something weird. But the nokoduko, if you want to be into extreme fermentology.
I don't know if that's a cooking question.
What's that?
Just how much info is in your head, Mike? Okay, his background, by the way, we met in college. He was pre-med. I was bio major. He went to work at a genetics lab for a couple of years, doing genetics research, variety of things. One of them was cancer gene research. And then decided to go to culinary school instead of medical school. So he does have the science background. I went to graduate school for genetic counseling. So my area is genetics. But just to...
Well, nature, if you keep it in balance, permaculture, nature does the hard lifting for you. You just have to do a little adjusting to make sure it keeps doing the right thing. We couldn't do it. You know, nature does so much more. Pickled eggs and beets. Yes, I love that. That's one of, I haven't made them a long time. One of my favorite pickled items is red beets, pickled egg, done properly with some nice spices.
That 1870s tried to do the pickled eggs. Didn't you? You were trying to do pickled eggs?
Oh, they were doing that. They were doing the oil or doing the water and lye eggs, right?
Yeah,
we watched that video. That was funny. That was a good video. That was a couple of weeks ago. Driving down to the roads, I think we were watching that.
Yeah, I think that was...
Cindy was driving and I was laughing at it.
Did you fold it up? Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah. And what was... Oh, botulism is not your main concern for that. So botulism needs to be in an airtight situation. Mm-hmm. I guess with the Sandy, you know, the brands... and stuff you could, but your big areas are, so you have salt retarding, bran, some of the brands, like rye brands and things, can grow some weird, some dangerous stuff, and I keep always
some
forgetting.
I don't know about bran, but I know some of the wheats, they had some growth on them that actually would cause hallucinogenic
issues.
Yeah,
there's, and that's, yeah. I think it was the rye, actually.
Was
so,
it rye?
Yeah, okay. You've got some, so funny thing is I run a rye sourdough starter, but it's in balance and it's already got a culture in it. So when you start playing with some of these things, you need to have ways of checking pH or knowing.
Lime. It was water lime.
Oh, lime. Yes, lime. Which is, well, lime and lime, yeah, pretty similar. So you're, pH on that. Lime is alkaline, though. And lye is alkaline. Okay. I believe it's creating the same
scenario.
Yeah. Lye is very dangerous if you use too much, by the way.
Yes.
Lime
Rachel
is
makes
less.
Soap, so she
yes.
knows.
Oh, yeah. She knows. I mean, lye can get you good if you don't get your hands clean and it's on there and you don't realize it. It's worse than acid. Being careful when you get into these ferments that you have a good culture and you know the steps of what causes it to go bad and what the signs are. Because some of you can't see, smell, taste, whatever.
Yeah.
But botulism, I don't think is your major concern. It's some of your other, and if you're keeping it in warm places, this is not warm. So you've got the salmonellas, the E. coli, some of that stuff will get you. It's canning, long holding and canning, and submerged in oil and submerged
they
in liquid, where botulism can get you good. Yeah. So, yeah.
Yeah. Water glassing.
Yeah. Water glassing. That's what Rachel was doing. Yeah.
Yes.
I saw somebody else, I think, preserving in oil at one point.
Hmm.
We've not tried that.
No.
So.
No, we just have been eating our eggs or selling them or giving them away. Any other cooking questions?
Yeah, lye turns fat into soap. It sure does.
Yes, it does.
Yep. That's the, and lye, like all your alkaline things, it feels good indication, by the way. If you have something that is acidic is going to burn quickly. You're going to feel the burn. Alkaline things you don't feel right away until it starts. It's called saponification, which is the process of making soap. Taking fat and taking alkaline substance, putting a lipid end on it and causing it to form basically soap, like you said. So it's taking the fat out of your skin, out of your cells. And at a point, it will get to a point where it gets to your nerve ends. And now you feel pain. And it's just as bad of a burn as an acid burn. But it you don't feel it. So if you put your hands under water and they feel soapy and you... but you haven't used soap, that's an indication that you still are alkaline, have an alkaline substance like lye on your hands, and keep rinsing until it stops. So not to mess around with making.
You want the veggies to taste more like bread and butter pickles, but not with the vinegar. I fell down the rabbit hole.
So bread and butter pickles, you start out with vinegar. You usually have a vinegar cook at first. A two-step on a lot of that, and then it's got a heavy sugar component. It's really a lot more sugar than you realize. And that goes on as a second, for it's a quick pickle. That's your second step, your spices and sugar and some vinegar, and that's the balancing. So by going real, real high sugar, you'll take out the sour. Yeah. You can also dilute your vinegar once you get your pickle. You can dilute your vinegar with water.
Emulsion, hallucinogen, no idea.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, there's some really scary stuff.
It was definitely.
Here, Art of Fermentation by Katz is one of the two. It's the orange book right there.
Oh, got it.
That is, he is the authority on pickling.
Too many camera things.
He's Israeli or something like that. I've not spent nearly enough time. Sandor Alex Katz. Michael Pollan, who's famous, of course, wrote the foreword. That tells you a little something because he doesn't write forewords to everybody's book. The Art of Fermentation, an in-depth exploration and essential concepts and processing from around the world. If you're serious about fermentation, this should be on your shelf.
I will have to put that in the kit. I will add that
and
to
I
the
have,
kit tonight.
I have not spent nearly enough time with this book, but that is...
That book that and the bread making book.
Those are two serious. Yeah, well, that's the bread machine book.
Yeah.
And she does a regular bread book too, but that author is.
Yeah.
If you want to dive into any one of those subjects on a moderately serious level as a hobby, start digesting those. Food science in general, by the way, for food, you have Harold McGee, which sometimes shows up with as little vignettes with. What's his name? On Food Network.
The guy who does all the science food
stuff. So Harold McGee's, he wrote two books. It's called On Food. He is a scientist, not a cook, who spent his life explaining why food does what it does. He's a pretty darn good.
Ergo.
He's not, he's a cook, he's not a chef. But I've met him. And On Food is high level high school, beginning level college, science of why things work. So if you're into a technical science end of it, you're going to love it and you'll read it, large sections of it. If you're not into that, like we were assigned it in culinary school. I don't know if they still do it. And I was reading it as candy after going to college. I'm like, this is great. This is putting together all the stuff I already know about and it's actually making it useful. And then I had students in my class like, I can't believe this is terrible. It's the worst thing I ever read. And I'm like, man, I'm reading this. I read it cover to cover because I wanted to.
Made onion soup with pork stock delicious and nothing in it can kill me.
That sounds good. That sounds great. I love a good caramelized onions. Take 30 minutes plus. All the work is getting the onions right. The last step is 15 minutes.
Yeah.
For a good traditional onion
and
soup.
And habanero bread and butter pickles are delicious. Hmm.
Mike was funny. What was I doing in the video with the roads? I don't know. I haven't seen it.
Oh, okay. When he was with Jonah milking the cow and Jonah was, or I'm trying to remember what other parts. That was a funny part, but that was partially Jonah. Oh, that was when you said that.
With pudding?
That we had big dogs because we didn't have big animals.
We were with a couple of the holler boys, and they were learning to milk.
Yeah.
And then I was with Jonah was and we were teaching. Getting ready to the video, the daily vlog where they're training to get the milking cow into the stanchion.
Yeah, Flossie.
And we were setting that up with Justin on the next try of the big tarps.
It was the one with the tarps.
That was right before shot that section.
Yeah. So I was kind of
Jonah
doing...
was helping. Jonah's going to be really, he is good. He's going to be really good.
I still think I keep
really good on the farm in like a year.
Not just that. I keep saying, I think he's already really good.
Yeah, he's really knows what he's doing.
Saying, whenever he does like a feature on Jonah, like when he made the log cabin and whatnot, I was like, when is this boy going to...
Brown, yes.
When is this boy going to start his own YouTube channel? Because he could completely
He's
going to
be so far ahead of most people if it's something that he really wants to do, he will be excellent on a homestead as a profitable, a making money, paying my bills homestead.
Yeah. So, yeah. I mean, he already spends his toy money on tools. That's what he spends his toy money on, which is so much fun. Yeah. That was Thanks Suburban. That is the video this week.
I didn't know much about others.
Yeah. Jonah is very wise and he does know, and he's curious and not afraid to ask those questions.
He was doing great butchering. He was going to town. I was afraid he was going to cut himself.
But he did.
I was looking at the adults like, are you sure you don't want him wearing a cut glove? And they're like, eh, whatever.
And, and then some of the holler boys got involved.
Yeah, I was like, I was really waiting for one of the kids to cut. And I don't mind a cut. I'm happy to help him with a cut. But I was just, obviously you can have bad cuts that cost money and are not good. They were doing great with doing the final trim ups and separations and grinding.
And Josiah was involved on that.
Yeah, they did really good.
And Lily got involved in packaging once we got to the packaging, the ground beef and stuff. So yeah. They're all involved in all that. It was a lot of fun.
Especially the second day, they're really hanging in. They're doing great.
That's funny. Don't tell Justin. Jonah's
the reason why I watch. Well, that, maybe that's the secret sauce. He needs to have more
of the kids.
More of the kids in there. Because you know, that's because everybody has their viewership reason.
Yeah, and I think that is a big part of it, is how much he involves the kids in not just the farm tours, but just the vlogs and everything too. So I do think they've even picked up the camera and they start filming as well.
He started to do a little bit, yeah.
So Jonah and Josiah both pick up the camera and start filming. And they're actually pretty good at getting it.
And the key to their homestead, I mean, the back scene of it is, I mean, it's no secret, but some people cover up a lot, or they're just kind of there, like, all right, we're going to go shoot a vlog, and they're totally different, or they're do their thing. That is because he's busy enough. He has notes, and somebody's sitting with a notebook. He has a plan of what he's trying to accomplish in a period of time.
It's basically and what he wants day. To do that day.
And,
yeah.
And so he has some form of a story to tell that makes some sense in a bigger picture. But he does the chores. They pick the segment of the chores that already is kind of fitting in, that makes the is the most interesting portion, sets up a camera, and pretty much goes through and does what he's going to do. There is no second take.
No.
Yeah, sometimes there's a moment to move a camera just because it needs to be there so you get a picture.
That takes extra time.
And that takes extra time, but it is otherwise very real life. There's nothing fake about it at all. So the old idea of reality TV of 15 years ago, which was not non-reality TV and so set up that, you know, but was kind of rougher filming and cruder formatting to make it reality. Well, we've totally come full circle, and it is total reality TV. They're just shooting what's going on and limitedly adjusting anything that's going on in their life for the camera. It's the camera's not the point of it. So that's the back end. And we watched them shoot here for 3 days and do things here and just their regular life. We spent 3 days with them.
They were on the farm too here for those of you guys who don't know.
And then we did the 3 days there.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's the same thing. So.
So yeah. Yeah, and a business. And they don't sell their food.
No, I mean, they don't sell any of their food, which is very different than most farmsteads.
They used to. He used to have a market garden and things. But at this point, it's more about the education and things. So there's the vlog. There's the membership and the membership videos, which, by the way, he is opening membership. If you guys are interested, he is opening membership back up for new members. I think it's February 3rd.
Oh, yeah, I saw that.
So I started putting an affiliate link to that membership down here in our description, including in this video. It's not open yet. It'll be open on the 3rd. But just if you guys are interested in that, there's a lot of educational videos on there. He has asked a few of us to submit some educational videos as well. And that's part of, you know, in exchange for the affiliate link below. So we did submit a video that is, it's another greenhouse video. It's basically the whole summary of how we put that greenhouse together, similar to our series, but it is, walking through it. It is a separate video. It's not the same as what we've already released. So, and they have a lot of other people submitting to it, but he specifically actually asked for that video.
They were very interested. First thing he said, because he had watched clips of it, which we're like, really? You watched part of that?
Well, I put on Instagram, and I think Rebecca
follows both our personal Instagram and our, a little bit from, which is
so
really
she
nice.
Saw the picture of the final thing off our front porch, and she wants to do it.
Winning the membership. That's a great plan.
There you go. Of course.
That's an excellent idea.
But she saw that off the front porch and said that's really what she wanted to do. In fact, we had a discussion on how they could turn their porch into a greenhouse a little bit.
Yeah, and they have a larger, different style. But
they
do.
But I think that's very doable if you replace the roof with some clear.
Yeah, which is for that setup not too bad. Yeah. So, we're reality TV at the finest. Yeah, I typically sit down and ask Cindy, what are we talking about 5 minutes before we start? That's how reality it is. At least on my end.
Yes.
Sometimes I know what the some of the topics are.
The live show. Yeah, I'll give them a heads up. I'm like, this morning, I haven't written it yet, but I think we're going to do our our feature this week on lavender, because I have some pictures of lavender. In the winter, I'm kind of stuck with what do I still have pictures of that I haven't talked about already. So I got to see how many more of those I can do.
We do need to find out about that sausage potato.
Yeah.
Sausage.
Who mentioned that?
I don't have idea.
Yeah, we might have to look that up if they're not still in the room. Do you have anything planted in the greenhouse yet? Not yet. Although, after we get through this cold snap, we do have a...
Cindy's got the whole dining room full of crap right now.
I have all our seed stuff in there, which is
the... Stuff, which was sitting in another room. One of our friends was over here today, and she's like, oh, you cleaned up that whole room, which had all the seed starting stuff. Like, no, yeah, it's all moved. In the dining room now.
No, actually, some of the seed starting stuff is back here because I want to go. I haven't ordered my seeds yet. I need to go through and see what we still have, but I also want to start some cold, hardy greens out there. And after this cold snap hits, we're supposed to warm back up into the 20s and 30s. But that means it'll be in the 40s and 50s in our greenhouse and maybe even warmer on the sunny days. And so I think I could start seeds in that. Uh-oh. Do I have an error? Okay, you guys, hold on. Do you guys still have us, by the way? We have an error on our screen. I don't see any... Have you seen any problems?
Not yet.
Okay. Can you guys just give us a heads up on if you guys still have connection to us? Because on our video, it's actually giving a weird screen. So if you could give us that. I guess you could still hear us because they just said heat wave. Yeah. Yes. Okay, good. So I'll just ignore the gray screen that we have on our watching.
On February 10th. Sounds about right.
Closes, but it opens on what day, Suburban Hillbilly? I think it was the 3rd, so maybe
there's
a
Yeah, and the other thing, so by the way, I don't know if he's released the official date, but if anybody's interested in doing a intensive 3-day hog fabrication class, rumor has it it's the first weekend of March.
Yes.
And I don't know when registration opens because I haven't heard, but it's got to be soon. I don't know the exact price.
I think he's opening it up this weekend.
It's got to be really soon because we're about a month out. But if you're really serious about what does it take to process a whole hog, do some cooking and charcuterie, this is going to involve a kill. And I'm going to be teaching the fabrication and the majority of the class. And Art is going to be assisting, and Justin and Hollers, I believe. So you got a pretty cool crew of people that you're probably following a lot of them. We are going to be doing real farmstead handling in a way that's taught, that's very interactive, and you could do it yourself. And then we're going to talk seriously about how you're actually going to use it or cook it so it becomes super usable. And there's a new packet that I'm going to create. Both that and the beef packet we're going to have available for a pretty low price very soon, although the pork packet is not finished, not even close to finished. So just so you know, those are some really good heads ups.
Utterkiss Hobby Farm, you're going in March.
Are you going to the
hog butchery? Awesome. So we will see you there. And I think he has it open for like 12 people or something.
12 is what I am hearing.
Very limited.
Yeah, 12. It's intensive. I mean, I'm sending equipment. We're hauling down a trailer of stuff.
Yep.
It's completely hand-tailored class. And I'm bringing 20 years worth of books and activities. I have broken down not hundreds of pigs, but quite a few. And so we're going to answer questions. And if people want to do more of something, we're going to do more in one direction. Of course, we're going to create the cuts and needs of for the roads. But that's and hogs, cool. By the way, hogs are way, way more practical than beef.
Yeah.
Beef, because of the size and cost.
You need friends.
And the amount of beef, you need to friends and you need to team up how it's going to get used. Because a really good grass-fed beef that you bought and didn't raise could cost $3,000. At least... Yeah, 12, 20. Yeah, I would call it $2,500 to $3,500, depending on where you are in the country, for a grass-fed specialty beef. And then you got to go through all the time and processing, and you got up to 600 pounds of beef. A small heritage hog is going to be 200 to 300 pounds, and it's a more usable item. So if you're talking about doing homestead fabrication, pork is, after chicken, pork is your start point.
Fabrication sounds more like putting it together than taking it apart.
Well, the way, when I took restaurant butchering classes, they said the largest industry in the United States is manufacturing or auto manufacturing. The second biggest industry, which nobody talks about, is demanufacturing, which is the removal of the abattoir and the taking apart of animals. And we don't talk, it's a huge industry, but it usually takes place in out in the country and out in out of the way areas because of smells and politics, and we don't focus on it. But we're not doing any of that. We're doing it the old way, and we're going to use every piece of it and cherish it. So it's a little different. American guinea hogs, I believe we're working primarily with guinea hogs.
Two of them guinea hogs, and then he's getting three, two new ones. There's a fifth one, I think.
They're all there. They had the three of them. Yeah. His three new ones were just posted on Instagram last night, and I did not hear people asking what breed, but they're under 250 pounds. And then he has some guinea hogs, which are also lard pigs. So they're fattier, which is fun. So that's if you're into the meat thing and want to learn more, even if you don't want to do it, you can learn so much about handling meat or how to take some of those cuts and process them yourself. That is, can be done on your kitchen table.
And by the way, we have a series that we're going to be starting that we started, we did start recording it a while ago, but we're going to start our own hog butchery series.
Yes, culling and processing, not killing and butchering. You're absolutely right. That's culling, processing, fabrication.
That probably helps with the YouTube as well, culling and processing.
I do cook vegan, by the way, too. I'm pretty adept at vegetarian and vegan. I'm non-discriminatory when it comes to food. I eat virtually everything. So I'm pretty good in both categories.
So for those of you guys who are interested, our next big series will be on the hog processing. So we did go to a friend's house this fall and helped him take, butcher two hogs. And then we helped him from culling all the way through.
Well, processing. We had five families. We had five Michigan YouTube families. And the host was not a YouTube family, but they are a YouTube follower.
It was us, Pratt Family Homestead, Homestead Dad,
Hodgepodge
Homestead.
It was a cool group.
And then
1870s couldn't make it. They were booked. They really wanted to go.
And one Instagram person as well, Stefan.
Oh, Stefan. Yeah, Stefan came out too.
And then we had our host.
It was a really good group. Anybody that comes to the Hootenanny, the Michigan Hootenanny, it was some people that have really had a great time going to that.
Yeah, it basically stemmed from that.
Yeah. Talked about, hey, we need some help. Hey, I don't know how to do that. Hey, I really don't want to do that on my property. I'm concerned. I'm scared. And all of a sudden, everybody walked away and said, you know what? I think this is something we could get value and do.
Yeah.
We don't have pigs. I know how to. I have not had not done a lot of the kill work, but I've done everything else. And because I don't handle pigs, we don't handle livestock. That's not my most comfortable area. I just, I could figure it out, but it's not what I do. I do the rest. And so there is rumor that Homestead Dad may be hosting some form of a workshop or a community training, formal, informal.
He's putting feelers out right now.
So if you're interested in something and you're in the Michigan Midwest area, they are outside of Ann Arbor, Jackson, southeast corner of Michigan.
They're north of Ann Arbor.
North of Ann Arbor. So if you're in that region, and I think, and I was looking at maybe a late March date or something. There's been in some talks of us coming down, and we'd love to if it fits our schedule. Obviously, if I'm there, I'll help and do whatever I can on that. But he's putting out feelers, so send him a note if you're into that.
Coming to Florida this time of year might be better than most time of year.
I like the cool weather for processing. It's the work goes easier, and I like doing it in the cold, a lot less ice.
Yes.
But too cold, I like to feel my fingers. So if you cut yourself, you cut yourself.
40s to 50s is probably the best processing weather.
That is 35 to 50 and not in direct sun for outdoor is perfect. So late fall, early, southern winter, northern early spring are ideal for outdoor. It just makes it easier.
And you don't have to deal with flies and you don't have to deal
flies
with
flies is a sun and fat starting to turn and melt.
Yeah.
But flies and maggots and bugs, those are real contaminant items. Not having them in the picture allows you to do it outside in what I feel is very safe conditions.
What's the difference between processing domestic hogs and feral hogs? They have lots of feral hogs.
Well, the cutting them down is no different. I mean, breaking them apart. So wild foraged or boar, or completely feral. So you will either be, if they're old, they could be really fatty and marbled, but more often they're going to be lean. They're going to have a dark red meat. Boar is dark red because they run around, they're exercise. They're going to have a nice porky flavor, a little richer, highly desirable for sausage and curing, by the way. But you, what they feed on is going to affect what they taste like. Damage or age will affect it. And we discussed that in our packet a little bit. Male, full pheromones and hormones can make them stinkier and stronger meat, which means you need to process them or remove more glands and things, to, which could make your meat stronger. And then that's what I was going to get to. Your biggest issue is parasites, where domestic, and I'm not saying even your forage pastured pork, you need to be a little more careful, depending on how you're raising, what's going on. But hog house, you don't have a parasite issue. You can cook it rare. When you're talking about foraged and wild, you need to cook it well done, because you don't know what's in there. And some of those parasites, if you don't, they're fine. They're just protein. Honestly, as gross as it sounds, even if you see them, the reality is if you were to eat the parasites and they're cooked, it's just protein. It's gross, but it is. It won't hurt you. If it's raw and they're alive, and then they can infect you. So they make awesome grinding chilies, fresh sausage, like Italian sausage, cured hung sausage, roasts, barbecue. If the meat's good quality, they're highly prized, but do cook them. Yeah, no question. Get them cooked.
Yep.
And get a thermometer in there all the way down deep. I've worked with wild boar, which is primarily like a state raised pseudo wild boar, and it's been very good. I have never had full on feral hog meat. Italy loves doing boar sausage, by the way, dried boar sausage. So
don't they have a lot of hair? Well, all
they all have a lot of hair.
They all have hair.
So you either skin or scald and scrape. But yeah, you're dealing with hair no matter what.
What if you freeze the meat first?
So there's something called certified pork. So you can ask for certified pork, or you can look up online what it means. So that means it has been frozen for a period of time to guarantee that that is where it will kill parasite eggs or living parasites. And so based upon the temperature, how cold will tell you how many days it needs before it's called certified. So if you're doing hung sausage, where you're curing it by salting and hanging it, and you're going to need to use your nitrates and that, you're going to want to always use certified pork. Yep. But you could certify it yourself by the same guidelines. Now, if you have like a minus 30 freezer, it's only a couple days. If you're a minus 10 freezer, whatever it is, it could be a couple of weeks or a month. But if you look up that, it's going to be a USDA or FDA sheet. You can look it up, find it easily. Follow those guidelines. You can do that at home and feel very safe about frozen. And that's why frozen fish, frozen meat that may be parasite prone, like most of your sushi is frozen fish, at least initially, even if it's flash frozen, because you eliminate the parasite issue if you're undercooking or cutting it wrong.
Yep.
So good thing to know about that.
Okay, you guys, it is 10:30 at night. And
the hair referred to Cooney.
The Cooney, do they not have hair?
Oh, are they hairless?
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know all the breeds of the hogs.
I always want to do a Kahlua pig. That's one thing we've been talking about. So Kahlua pig is not bathed in Kahlua. It's wrapped in leaves and buried in
Hawaiian style.
In a pit or with hot rocks. I would love to do a goat or a sheep or a pig or something. I've never done a deep hole style buried. But then you need to have like 50 or 100 people over.
Art and Brie.
So if you guys don't want to come over,
we can have a big
but that together. That's something I have on the list that sometime I would like to do.
We can ask if they would allow it at Hootenanny.
Yeah, you have to set it up. You have to set the pit a day before, and a lot of times you preheat, you burn out the pit, and you get the soil hot.
Yeah,
depending on the style. I mean, you could do a straight pit where you do a drop similar to what Art was doing with cinder blocks or stones, where you just create a heat pit. number of different methods.
Yeah.
But it cooks all day, so you need to set it up the day before if you're going to have it for lunch, especially, and you got to tend it all night. But yeah, and a lot of times they're rubbed down with like an adobo and then wrapped in burlap or in heavy palm or other you know, other methods. So it's really steaming, honestly. So you got the spices, and then it's steaming, and then it's got the a little bit of smokiness from the wood around it. But that I would love to do that. Real barbecue is hardwood, you know, logs broken down into hot coals, pit smoking, in earth smoking, barbacoa. That is the barbecue grill is great, but when you're talking about real barbecue, that's the masters.
That's a little bit traditional too.
It takes some skill and some time.
Yeah.
Take your time, but it'll come out amazing.
Okay, guys. Yeah. It is getting late.
We still don't know about the sauce, the potato sausage.
Oh, I guess we'll have to look that one up. But, and I did see something on the question on prion diseases and stuff.
Prion is not heat killed. No. I don't think pork, I'm not aware of pork having a prion issue. There are prion issues that affect humans and prions that only affect other species, so that's good to know.
Chronic wasting disease.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
that would be more like in the deer.
We're having an issue with chronic wasting is being monitored, and they're trying to tackle that aggressively in Michigan, mostly on the east side of the state, but they believe it's moving aggressively around, may move across the state, obviously. So everybody in Michigan, they're encouraged to bring in a sample before the processors. I don't think you have to, but they're highly encouraging it to be checked, and they'll for free
test it.
Tell you so you don't eat any of it. It has not transferred from to humans yet.
No.
But they believe it's a matter of time and it will. So cutting down the spread of it and preventing it from humans, because venison is such a big activity in Michigan.
Yeah.
I'm not a hunter. I just didn't grow up in that tradition and having the access to do that. But I love eating the wild game. So, yeah, I'm concerned about it, too. I don't want to I want to continue to eat it. My neighbor just gave us some backstrap, actually.
So I guess. Yeah, it is late. We got to get going.
Yeah, I got stuff to do. I got a crazy busy week, and we got to figure out extreme cold as well as a pretty good snowstorm coming in tonight. And I've got to run groceries and errands all day tomorrow.
Crazy week. He's going to be running errands. I have to go to work.
I may take the plow truck out because we have one car with all-wheel drive, which Cindy will take to work, which means I've got the car, which is good in the snow, but not good in a storm.
No.
So I may take the old plow truck out with me, but it's a beast. It's
got
the plow and it's a full size pickup, and so I don't mind driving it, but it's a 3/4 ton 95 Dodge, so there's no frills on it, and it's a stick too. So
So everybody stay safe, and if you're in the snowstorms, we will
send
see pictures, you guys.
Send Instagram.
Yes, tag us on Instagram if you have.
We like looking at it.
And we will see you guys next week.
I'm out of milk, but I got
milk and bread.
Yeah.
What is
Long
it? Milk,
Island.
Milk, eggs, bread, and beer is what they all get in the East Coast. And I'm like, what are you making? You're making French toast and having beer with it for your snowstorm.
For all of you who haven't looked up the viral, the guy on Long Island on the storm stand.
It's not kid friendly, is it?
That's not that bad.
I thought he was the guy who was swearing left and right.
Oh, he did a couple videos. He might have got a little more so.
Yeah. So, but it's hilarious.
It's so real because we lived not on Long Island, but we lived north of New York City
for a while.
People ransacked the shelves of everything like they're not going to eat for a month. It's like, come on, guys. It's going to be like a day, and then we're going to plow out like, oh, it's not a hurricane where you're knocking out the whole place.
Yeah. Well, they did that for those too.
Yeah.
Anyway, stay safe, everybody. Yeah. Toilet paper. Yeah, toilet paper is good.
Toilet paper, very important.
although you could just, it's winter. You can't find mullein this time of year, but there's.
You need the toilet paper.
You need toilet paper. We will see you guys next week.
When and where is the farmer's market? Farmer's market in the winter is, regular summer's farmer's market is on Bank Street. Bank Street is off of Crosstown Park. It's between Crosstown Parkway and Burdick and Portage, basically. It's behind John Park.
All those streets.
So Bank Street, look it up. It's only about a block. long.
It's in the bingo hall this time
and,
of year.
And in the winter, it's in the bingo hall, which is across from the main market. The other cool place, and please come down and see us. I know you're local. I'd love to meet you in person. I know we've chatted and about doing stuff.
When? It's on Saturday mornings. Winter market is 8 to 1.
8 to 1.
And the rest of the year.
7 to 2.
7 to 2.
And then there's some other weekday markets. Bronson Hospital has a brand new grocery store, marketplace grocery store. They took over half of their gift shop. Coolest idea. Took over half of their gift shop and turned it into a grocery store. They are selling local products, generally healthy products, produce from local farms, and some other assorted things.
At the hospital.
At the hospital. It's next to the emergency area on the sky deck area, so it's real easy. Right in the gift shop. Prices are not inflated. They're actually similar to a grocery store. The idea is that people coming through for any reason or even off the street could buy a limited the things they have.
And the pasta's there.
I do have my pasta there. And they also... and then many staff leaving so that you can buy a healthier food item than a junky food item. Mm-hmm. And you can grab a couple items and walk out and go home. So some fresh fruits, vegetables, a few prepared, some meats, frozen meats, a little bit of dairy and butter, and some, there's some like healthy granola snacky things like dough chicks and stuff. So that's really, really cool. It's groundbreaking activity at our local hospital.
Yeah. So for those of you local, I know Kalamazoo Permaculture is. So that's where you can find the pasta locally. But we are
And we do Texas Corners also, which is in Texas Township. We do that market during their market season, which is a little shorter than the Kalamazoo market season.
May through October or something like that, Texas Township.
Just market. Makes sense. Yeah, they're really on a mission for changing food access and food use in downtown Kalamazoo and the rural areas. For whatever reason that people aren't eating healthier foods due to money access, whatever, they're really putting a lot of money, like serious money. They're not joking around. It's not a PR campaign.
They're trying to go 70% local.
Yeah, they're at 45-ish% local. Yeah. We're part of helping them bring in some pasta each week. Eggs, oatmeal, really core items are coming from local farms and producers, and they are serving them legitimately throughout the hospital in a lot of their meals. Other hospitals are doing a great job. Some are putting up advertisements and who knows what they're doing. They're not there yet, but Bronson over the last few years is very, very serious about their food program right now. So
anyway, and we talked for 5 more minutes.
Yeah, I know.
We will catch you guys later. We will be back next week, Sunday. I'm not sure how my timing will be on getting another featured item, but we will be live at 9 o'clock.
Yeah, we got major, we got a major
Saturday's
pasta event
booked.
Tomorrow. Saturday. It's
Saturday all day is booked. So
Sunday we'll be sleeping in and recovering, I think, but we will be up and definitely back. So,
yeah. So, yeah, we will see you guys next week, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, same time, same place.
Yep, food desert is the word that's talked about, and it is seriously being tackled. So.
Yep. Okay, take care, you guys. Bye.